Next up, we have Angie Patterson here at Black Rock Forest. She's going to be talking about leaf physiological response to temperature of northern, central, and southern range trees in a northeastern U.S. temperate forest. I think I still have to unmute Angie. Huh? Sorry, Angie. There you go.
All right. Thanks, everyone. So I'll also try to be quick. Today I'll be speaking to you about the research that I've conducted on the physiological responses of trees to elevated temperatures. Okay, so since the early 1800s, observations of organismal responses to climate change have been recorded, and we can expect that even more drastic responses to occur as projected air temperatures increase by 2 to 5.5 degrees Celsius over the next century. And the pressures induced by climate change factors include migration events for many forest organisms. However, plants are sessile and thus more vulnerable to climate change, relying solely on seed dispersal and then successful establishment and then reproduction to ensure a thriving population. So several other observations that we've seen include a lengthening of the growing season for plants and an earlier flowering phenology. And scientists are also seeing migrations where species ranges are either shifting or contracting or expanding. But the migration patterns aren't resulting in plants just moving anywhere, but instead plants in general are moving or migrating northward, like towards Canada or up mountains, which are cooler and less stressful than where they are now. So just wanted you all to take a look at this photo. Scientists took photos of a mountainside in Sweden near the Arctic tree line, as depicted by these black lines on the photos. And these tree lines mark the boundary where conditions inhibit the growth of shrubs and trees. So in 1977, you can notice that the shrubs cease to pass this line. However, as climate conditions become more favorable, shrubs and trees have expanded their range and moved upwards towards the mountain. So over the last 126 years, the average annual temperatures in the northeastern United States has actually become much warmer. And this graph here shows the departure of the average annual temperatures from the 20th century average over time. So if we were to draw a trend line across the last 100 years or so, we find that the temperatures have risen about 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. And if we look closely at the latter years only, we'd actually find that warming has increased at a faster rate of about 0.5 degree Fahrenheit per decade. So of course you have this interannual variability where some years are cooler than others, but over the last decade, the departure from the mean has been consistently above the century average. So in the Hudson Valley region of New York State, last year's summer temperatures have departed from the century average by about 3.7 degrees Fahrenheit alone. So we ask, so we see a northward movement of warmer temperatures. Tree ranges are also shifting in order to track their preferred climates. But what could happen if trees that come from different climates of origin don't shift their range in time and instead experience temperature regimes that they may not be adapted to? So this schematic shows what could happen if populations experience a mismatch with future climate. So on the left picture, blue trees are currently living in the colder climates they've become adapted to, while the yellow trees are living under warmer climates they've adapted to, with green trees living somewhere in the middle of that range. But with climate change, we can expect to get a mismatch between the genotypes of populations and the climate that they find themselves in, as the cold environment actually becomes warm and the warm environment becomes hot. So gray trees represent mortality or health problems associated with a maladaptation to the new climate they're experiencing. So as temperatures increase, we need to begin to understand which species will be able to survive here and how will the forest composition change in the next 50 to 100 years, how that would change and how will that actually affect the carbon dynamics of our forests. So Black Rock has already seen changes in forest composition over the span of 76 years. in which two northern and one centrally ranged tree species had become extirpated or locally extinct from the from Black Rock Forest, and 11 southern ranged trees had migrated in. An example of the historic range distributions of some species used in my study include the southern ranged pignut hickory, whose northern edge hits this region, the centrally ranged red oak, and the northern ranged paper birch, whose southern edge hits this region. So to understand how forest carbon dynamics may change under a warmer climate, we need to understand how trees are cycling carbon and determine if they're able to acclimate or adapt their physiology to optimal levels, ensuring physiological competitiveness that's needed to survive, grow, and reproduce. So the physiological processes that will dictate this is photosynthesis, in which plants take up carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, water from the soil, and use light energy from the sun to produce sugars that's needed to grow and the oxygen that is required for us to breathe. And through respiration, which is the opposite of photosynthesis, plants break down those sugars that they produced by using oxygen and metabolic energy to produce carbon dioxide, water, and energy that is needed to power photosynthesis and sustain a tree's growth, reproduction, and repair. So to truly understand the physiological mechanisms that determine how effective these trees are at removing CO2 from the atmosphere, we actually go down one more level to estimate the rates of specific reactions that are happening within the photosynthetic and respiration pathway. So the first part of the photosynthetic process captures the light energy from the sun within the chloroplast. And we call this the light reactions of photosynthesis, which is denoted as Jmax. We also estimate the dark reactions of photosynthesis, which is denoted as Vcmax, which describes the binding of carbon dioxide with the 5-carbon molecule named RUBP with the help of the enzyme RuBisCO. Sugar is then created, where some is regenerated back into the Calvin cycle as RUBP. And this rate of regeneration is denoted as triose phosphate use, or TPU. And eventually the sugar produced is broken down or metabolized into in the mitochondria, and the plant respires or breathes CO2 at night. And that's denoted as dark respiration, or RD. So I've measured all of these components in my experiments, but while presenting carbon assimilation, which describes the rate of carbon gained through this entire photosynthetic process, as well as Vcmax, and dark respiration of many of the tree species that we knew very little about in regards to their physiology and their response to elevated temperatures. So now that you have a more thorough understanding of the physiological components that's happening within a leaf, it's necessary to understand how a plant's physiological response could change as temperatures increase. So this graph shows the response of both photosynthesis and respiration to temperature. And each species has a different optimal temperature at which photosynthesis or carbon gain is at its highest. And in return, respiration or carbon loss is low enough to actually maximize the net carbon gain. So as temperatures increase, photosynthesis deviates from its optimum and decreases, and respiration increases, which decreases the net photosynthesis. And in this scenario, the temperature response of this plant's physiology isn't able to acclimate or have the ability to compensate by changing their physiology back to optimal levels. However, in an acclimation scenario, the photosynthetic and respiration rate would actually bounce back to a similar optimum at a new temperature. So as tree range migrations continue and annual air temperatures rise, we wanted to know how co-occurring trees that have a northern, central, or southern range distribution respond to elevated temperatures in order to gain a deeper understanding about forest carbon dynamics resulting from species composition changes. So my field research was done here at Black Rock Forest, which is predominantly made up of red oak. And it's a great place to do this type of work due to the long-term research on species replacement over the last 90 years. And it's a site where we see these tree range distributions overlap. So using the shotgun method, my crew was able to retrieve canopy tree branches growing in full sunlight in order to reduce variation in the physiological response of these sampled leaves. And then we retrieved the branches and measured their leaf porosity and placed the plants in water, cutting their stem twice to ensure optimal water uptake. Healthy looking leaves in this experiment from a total of 16 different broadleaf species were then chosen for use in the light core, which measures leaf level gas exchange. And I measured their net photosynthetic rates at three different temperatures across 11 CO2 levels. We also measured leaf traits, which include leaf mass area, which describes the leaf structurally, where a thinner and broader leaf usually would have a lower leaf mass per unit area, or a low L, or a smaller and thicker leaf contributes to a higher L. So we conducted carbon nitrogen analysis on ground dried leaf tissue to determine how much carbon and nitrogen are in a sample. And from there, we were able to calculate the carbon to nitrogen ratio, as well as the nitrogen content per leaf. So since nitrogen is the predominant compound of the Rubisco enzyme, plants with higher nitrogen usually have higher rates of photosynthesis and therefore respiration. So before we can talk about how species respond to elevated temperatures, we need to see how they're operating at a common temperature. So these graphs show the rates of photosynthesis or carbon gain on a per unit leaf area at a common temperature, 25 degrees Celsius, across species, and then binned by their historical range distributions. So as you can see, there's a lot of variability across species. However, if you bin them by range distribution, you find statistically similar rates, which suggests that these trees may have acclimated to this region's current temperatures. The Jmax and TPU rates are not shown here because they too did not show significant differences across range groups. This graph here shows the respiration rates or the rate of carbon loss across northern, central, and southern species. And here we find that the northern and southern species have the highest rates of respiration. However, when we look at the carbon gained to carbon loss ratio or the carbon use efficiency, we find no differences between these range groups, further suggesting an acclimation to this region's current average growing temperatures. But keep in mind that as the average air temperatures increase, these ratios could likely change as well and show different responses altogether. So the next set of graphs show the photosynthetic capacity or Vcmax, which if you're a car enthusiast is like describing your metabolism. It's like the engine of a Ford or a Ferrari. And you have two types of engines that can get you to the same destination, but which one has that innate potential to propel you through that carbon fixation process at a faster rate. So here we see that the central range species had a lower capacity to assimilate carbon dioxide than their northern and southern counterparts. And this suggests that centrally ranged species may have a physiological disadvantage that may contribute to slower growth or reproduction when compared to their southern and northern counterparts. And in conjunction, the southern and northern species' high rates of respiration, the potential loss of this dominant oak species, which is a central range tree at Black Rock, due to threats such as deer browsing or mortality, due to periodic disturbances and increased competition with fire-sensitive species, could threaten the carbon sink potential of the forest. So, how do these trees respond under elevated temperatures? So the graph to the left shows the response of photosynthesis to temperature for all species lumped together. And on the right, the graph shows the response when we partition out by range group. On the left, you can see that there's no statistical significant change across temperature. However, when you split these out by range group, photosynthesis doesn't significantly change across temperature when looking within a range, but an interesting pattern shows central trees assimilation rates consistently ranking lower than northern and southern trees. And when all species were actually lumped together, we can see that the photosynthetic capacity of these trees increases and then stabilizes under elevated temperatures. And when partitioned out, we do see no significant differences within a range group. However, central range again kind of has this pattern where it increases and then slightly decreases under elevated temperatures. Here for leaf traits, we do find some differences. We find that southern trees had this lower foliar L and higher mass-based nitrogen, and therefore lower carbon to nitrogen ratio. And northern trees had higher area-based nitrogen than southern trees and comparably high foliar L and CN to northern, to central range trees. So although these species from differing climatic provenances were able to maintain similar amounts of carbon gain at ambient CO2 levels, as represented by Amax or photosynthesis and carbon use efficiency variables, their photosynthetic capacities vary significantly, where the centrally ranged trees may be physiologically disadvantaged when compared to their northern and southern counterparts under a warmer climate. The leaf traits may have contributed to the physiological performance. And then in addition,
That's 15 minutes, Angie.
Okay, no problem, I'll just wrap it up here. In addition, this low photosynthetic capacities of central range species paired with this high respiration rates of southern and northern range species may promote carbon loss from this region's forests, which may further increase atmospheric CO2 concentrations, perpetuating climate shifts and creating uncertain features for resident tree species in this region. Just want to acknowledge everyone who helped me in this, and thank you.
Thank you.